When you're 16 years old and someone calls you fat or stupid, you're like, that's real.
Hi guys, it's Kirby. Welcome back to Pretty Unfiltered. I am so excited about today's guest. It's Alexa Losey.
Hi.
You guys know her and love her from her channel, obviously. But I am so glad that you're here because I just have to say, do people tell you that you're just like chill? Very chill.
No.
Cool as a cucumber?
No.
Maybe. I want to talk about when you first started your channel, 2010, right?
Yeah. Like, I don't remember life before wanting to think about, like, uploading something. Or,
really?
Like, sharing something. Yeah. I don't really remember.
Because I feel like you gained a lot of followers very quickly.
It was...
For that time, at least, right?
Yeah.
Like, 30K in 6 months.
Yeah, and that was really big for, like, back in the day. In the beginning, it grew really fast, and then I went through a phase where I, like, kind of just shut down. Didn't think I was ever gonna come back to YouTube. I think I'd hit like 100,000 followers. And I was like, I'm done. I'm not gonna do this anymore. This is not what I'm meant to do.
Why?
Because I went through like a really depressive state. Mm-hmm. And I can say that like I think I was too young to get into YouTube when I did. I'm glad I did because I learned a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But I think like having that pressure and even having 100,000 people, I feel like now when you see all these kids, especially young kids that have like millions of followers, like it's not like you're like, oh, that's not a big deal. But it is a big deal to be like 16 and like go to a new school and everybody know you for being a YouTuber. You're kind of like, this isn't right. This doesn't feel right. Like, you'd get comments and you think like, oh, you should be able to like brush those off. But when you're 16 years old and someone calls you fat or stupid, you're like, that's real.
Did you feel like when you came out with your video about going to the mental hospital,
yeah.
Do you feel like people started tiptoeing around you? Like, did you feel like anything changed?
It was really weird because that was my biggest fear going into it. It was something where I kind of woke up one day and my manager was like, she'll ask me on Wednesdays, like, oh, what are you making today? I just kind of want to gauge it, just kind of see if I can help you, like, put it out in a better way, whatever.
Totally.
I was like, I'm going to do this one thing. You might think it's weird. Let me do this. I'm ready for it. It's been 5 years. Like, I'm ready to talk about it. But I think when you share something like that, you can't plan it. Originally, that was my biggest fear, was that my friends were going to find it, especially friends that, like, are newer friends that don't really know that about me, that think I'm a very, like, strong person, that, like, don't... I think I put those stigmas, like, the stigmas around it are still always going to stick with you to an extent. Like,
yeah.
Oh, they're going to think about this, or maybe they won't like me because they know I was unstable at this point, or whatever. And I think it was the polar opposite. I had people that I thought were really strong and had it all together come to me and say, like, I went through the same thing, or like, I wish I would have known about that in high school, or like,
totally.
Thank you for talking about that. That's something so difficult only my family know. I've had friends, like guy friends, that are like known on the internet for being very like masculine and very together, no feelings, like they don't care, whatever. One of them called me and was like, I'm broken. I don't have anyone to talk to. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to do. Would you suggest this? Could you help me find a place? Could you help me find somebody?
Yeah.
And it was just one of those things where I was like, how did I now become this like poster child for mental health?
It could be hard to reach out for help.
Completely,
and
yeah,
and I know that at least, you know, when people do struggle with depression and anxiety, mm-hmm. 1 in 3 people don't seek help. But I love too that you're not saying that you were, you know, this wasn't some courageous thing that you did.
No, not
either.
At all. If anything, I wish I would have done it sooner. I wish I, like, it had to get to the point where it was bad. Like, I wasn't able to function. I would, like, tell my mom I was sick. And for me to miss school was a big deal because I was an IB student.
Yeah.
And, like, I didn't have a reason to miss school. Like, at this school, I wasn't getting bullied. Like, I was very under the radar. I did my YouTube channel. I had all this stuff, whatever. Like, it was a big deal that I wasn't showing up to meetings and I didn't want to do anything. It's like, I know because I tend to, like, take my, like, anxiety out on food. If I stop eating and I have no desire to eat, it's when things are really, really bad.
Totally.
And so that's when I was like, this is the first time I, this is, yeah, this is needs to be addressed.
I wanna say though, like, you saying all these things, I think is so important for your fans and the viewers right now, because like those moments where you're like, wait, this isn't right,
mm-hmm.
that's what prompted you to talk to your parents.
Completely.
And I think that is so important to recognize because, you know, some of you might be scared. Some of you might not mm-hmm. know that this is the time to go talk to your parents or talk to somebody that you trust that's an adult that can help you.
Yeah.
So thanks for sharing that.
Because sometimes it's not always your parents too.
Exactly.
For some people, they don't have that.
Yep.
School counselors can do the same thing. Like,
exactly.
And that's the thing is, I think it was another thing where like a school counselor, the person that told me I really needed help was my teacher. I had a history teacher. We weren't like close. He really wasn't close to anybody, but he pulled me off to the side one day and he was just like, I've noticed that like you don't look like yourself anymore.
Mm.
Like you don't act like yourself. You don't raise your hand in class. Like, is everything okay? Like, is everything at home okay? Are you okay? And I just kind of looked at him and I was like, I'm fine. And then started like bawling and broke down.
Yeah.
He was like, do you want to go talk to your counselor? And I was like, I do. And then he told me, he was like, as your teacher, I'm here to support you. I know you're an IB student. Whatever you choose to do, I will go out of my way to make sure I can help you as a teacher to help you succeed as much as possible.
Huh.
So it took somebody kind of helping me along, but teachers are there for you. Like adults in your life as a teenager, they want to see you do well.
Of course.
Everyone wants to see you do well, and doing well is also taking care of yourself, and taking care of yourself is priority over everything.
How do you take care of yourself now?
Now, I always call it my five-year-old. I say that like I am responsible for taking care of a five-year-old and myself. Like my five-year-old gets hungry, my five-year-old needs sleep. Yeah. If my five-year-old is sad, what do I need to do to make sure that five-year-old is taken care of? And like that was the way that I had to visualize taking care of myself over like, my five-year-old's exhausted, but I want to make this person happy. My five-year-old needs sleep before I go to this person's like friend of friend's birthday party.
Exactly.
It's like stuff like that where like if I get, cause I get like paranoid that I'm like not pleasing people or whatever. It's like—
Are you a yes person?
Yeah, I'm a yes person, absolutely.
And that's my dad. I was just gonna say, I'm like, this sounds like a yes person.
But just stuff like that, or if it's like there's too much workload, I'm like, what's my priority? What does the five-year-old need? Okay, the five-year-old's tired, but the five-year-old can handle this. Let's take on this project or let's not or whatever.
Okay, so let's talk about what's coming up for you. You have Immortals, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's talk about Immortals, because this is a big deal. How did Immortals come about?
So Immortals is like, I realized subconsciously a lot of like issues in relationships that I've had. So I had a dream one night, and it was the night before I was going to pitch another idea to New Form, and I didn't really know what a pitch was. I didn't really know what I was doing. Mm-hmm. I was almost 21. I was still 20 when it happened.
Okay.
And I told my manager like, oh, I want to make like a little project or whatever, and she was like, okay, let's go meet with New Form. They've been interested in you, whatever. So I like had this idea for like a really, really like poor, it was really like poorly constructed short film. And they were like, we don't really make short films. And I was like, but that's what I've seen you guys make. They're like, oh, those are incubator pilots. And I was like, I have an amazing idea for a pilot. My manager's like, you don't know. Like, you haven't discussed this with me. What are you doing? And I had a notebook and I had like written down everything in my dream. And I was like, well, I had this dream last night. Like, hear me out. And Melissa kind of looked at me and she was like, okay. And then after she got done, she was like, that's really great. Let's talk about working on this. So then we kind of like went back to the dream, went back to the notebook. We kind of fleshed it out. We then like got a writer, worked with the writer for like 6 months. Wow. And all the producers and everybody, got the director, and we casted it, and then we filmed it. And everyone showed up on set one day.
And then it happened.
We filmed this thing, and now it's on New Form's YouTube channel.
Can you tell us a little bit of the synopsis?
Yeah, so it's about a girl that's 19, and she is immortally 19. She will be 19 forever, ever, ever, ever. And the only person that she believes is also immortal is her dad, who's also 19. So once you get to 19, you stop aging. So she's really like 120 or so, and her dad's probably like 200.
Mm-hmm.
But if someone finds out that you're immortal, they die. So that's why us as humans, we don't know any immortals, because if we did, we would die. That's why all these random deaths like occur too. Like it's like, oh, someone got hit by a tree. They found out someone was immortal and on their way home got hit before they could tell anybody else. And so you also kind of can't get too close to somebody, because if they find out you're immortal, the person that you love is gonna die. So this girl, Riley, has to reset her life every 6 years. And her dad comes back and helps her reset her life. But for the first time, she's kind of fallen in love with somebody, and her and that person decide to restart their life together. So she's trying to find a way to keep this person that she loves from finding out that she's immortal. But all these things in this new town start occurring, and she meets another immortal for the first time, which she didn't know existed.
So, I love this. Yeah, I love this. This is so smart. And you just had a dream about this.
Yeah, and a lot of it was like sitting in the writer's room and fleshing it out more.
Totally.
Like the basic synopsis and like the rules of the world all happened in the dream. Oh. So like the character of like Riley and the dad, like that was in my dream. And like the girl was in the dream, the girlfriend.
Mm-hmm. I love that you touched on that you wrote this down in a journal.
Mm-hmm. I journal
after you
every
had
day.
It. Every day. That's so smart. Like for people out there that are super creative, but they maybe feel restricted because they just have so many ideas and don't mm-hmm. know how to execute them.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for them? Obviously, maybe journal every day, but anything else?
I think honestly, like it sounds crazy, I have multiple journals for different things, and they're all like black moleskins, because I like the idea of everything creative being in something that's like very not like boring
yeah.
looking, and they're all lined up on my shelf, and they're like my prized possessions are like my moleskins. I go through like one a month.
That's amazing.
But I think, yeah, it's writing down everything you think of. And like, I used to feel limited. I used to be like, oh no, they have to look a certain way. I have to like write about it in a way, whatever. And just kind of like scribbling everything. And eventually you write about writing, and you write about creating, and you write about what you want or where you want to see yourself. So I think always making the mood boards,
mm-hmm.
that's really important.
Yeah.
I did one of those in the hospital. Crazy story.
Yeah.
I had a nurse that I like really connected to. And I mentioned in the video, he was this person that was kind of like really push me to like one direction.
Mm-hmm.
And he made me before I left, he goes, I want you to make a mood board of everything you want in 5 years. He goes, everything you want, print it out, let's go, let's do everything. So I made this board and I was at my parents' house visiting for Christmas and I was like, oh, what's this? I found the mood board. It was 5 years later, I looked at it and it's my life right now.
No way.
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Wait, I actually...
So that's why I think if you have anything you want to do that's creative and you're like in a dark spot, make a board, put it away, and you will find it in 5 years and it'll be your life. But making the journals, making the mood board, and I think just doing it, like even if you think it's gonna be bad, because that's my thing, it's like, I don't wanna be a creator if it's gonna be bad. Like, I don't wanna be an artist if it's gonna like look bad.
Yeah.
But then I look at my friends who are like such admired artists and like such admired creators, people that I admire and I know a lot of people admire, and then I see the stuff that they make, and then I see their final products, and I'm like, yeah, your first one was awful.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's like everyone's process. It's like even the best, most amazing creators, their first like step one was like,
correct,
terrifying.
Yeah.
So it's like, just don't be scared of it, I guess.
And also just do it. I think that's, yeah, half the battle, is actually like putting pen to paper or whatever it is, mm-hmm, and doing it. Because otherwise, I mean, and I say that, but it's hard for me too. I have all these ideas and I'm like, oh, I want to do this, but I have yet to do it. So it's just like,
executing,
reminder,
and doing,
yeah,
it.
Execute, reminder to me. Alexa, thank you so much.
Thank you for having
you
me.
You are awesome. Guys, let me know your favorite part of this interview in the comment section below.
So
subscribe to Pop Sugar Girls Guide, obviously. New episodes of Pretty Unfiltered every Wednesday. So if you have a guest idea or something that you want us to talk about, please, please, please let me know. All right, guys, we'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.